Tennant. Doctor Who?
Broadchurch, no. Postman part of the movie?
Yeah, that's it. Listen, tell me how this works. You pull out of a TV show last minute and you get the night off. My agent's got me on this show, The Last Leg, tonight, but I saw what you did with Piers Morgan. I thought I might do the same. I don't know, I'll come up with some reason. I'll just say I don't like the guy that looks like a hobbit. Or I could say I can't stand it when the Aussie guy sings. No, I know. I'll just say I hate the disabled. No? Yeah. Yeah, you're right. I'll probably just do the show. Cheers, mate.
What goes on? Thank you for letting us be ourselves. So don't mind me if I repeat myself. These simple lines be good for your health. To keep them crime rhymes on the shelf. Live my life like you just don't care. 5,000 leaders never scared.
Click on the telly, check out the news and realise you're not going to make it through dry January. It's Friday, we're live, and it's time for The Last Leg. Tonight on the show, Theresa May goes cheek-to-cheek with Donald Trump. Piers Morgan gets left alone on the dance floor. And cancer research does the mashed potato. Plus, we'll be joined on the couch by actor David Tennant. On the show that tap dances its way around the news. Welcome to The Last Leg, the show that has a studio audience of 3 million and an audience at home who is too clever to fall for that bullshit. With me on the couch, as always, are the pride of Dartmoor, Josh Widdicombe, and the man whose most exciting moment of the last month came when he had a shirt finally tailor-made to fit his arms, Alex Brooker. Now, this was the first... I have the shirt here. This is the first shirt you've ever made. You've ever had made... to fit your arms.
And look at that! I genuinely never realised how small my arms were until I fell.
You didn't realise you had small arms?
Not like that. It's like a T-shirt, almost. It's ridiculous. The thing is, though, I texted my mates and I was just like, why did nobody ever say? I could have talked about it on TV.
I'd have thought you'd have noticed.
I genuinely, when the bloke brought that shirt out, honestly, I looked at it and thought, I mean, that's going to be too short. And then I put it on, I was like,
So you've never realised, have you just been going through life not realising, just thinking, why can't I get my hands in my pockets?
What amazes me, though...
You've gone through life unable to do that thing where you tap people on the wrong shoulder. That must be awful.
What amazes me, that is the most exciting thing that's happened to you over the last month, and yet 2 weeks ago, Alex Brooker became a father.
Just so you know, that's me on the right.
And she's wearing a shirt that was tailored for your arms.
Have a look at that photo, by the way. Our poll for tonight, which person in that photo had just filled their pants?
It's amazing.
It's exciting. I've not met a Timberlake yet, but I can't wait to meet her.
You've gone there, Timberlake?
Timberlake Thierry Brooker, that's what you told me she was called.
If you start saying she's bringing sexy back, when she's older, mate.
Well, that's an awkward start to the series.
And the thing is, you've kept it a secret on air. You didn't want to talk about it as part of the show.
No.
But you and I have had chats about this.
Yeah.
And I have two questions for you. One, at what stage during the pregnancy did you count the toes and fingers?
Well, the 12-week scan, the fellas turned around. Most people get, you know, a picture of, like, the little baby. He did the... The full one, he's like, yeah, it's got, you know, all its hands and feet. And I'm just like, oh, I wanted it to be a surprise. Also, you know, you want her to take
like
after...
You always want your arms.
You always want your kids to take after you as well, didn't you? So...
Well, and here's the big thing, because I know that you've been fretting over the past few months about whether or not you were going to be able to pick her up with
your arms. Yeah, and, you know, a lot of people would have seen some of the stuff I said, you know, at the Paralympics when I was saying, you know, I was worried about whether I'd be able to hold my child. And it's genuinely, it's not something that's worried me the last few months. It's something that I've worried about. Ever since when you get to a stage when you're like kind of, you know, 14, 15, you start thinking about stuff like that. It is something that I've always worried about. And, you know, my mate Paul just said to me, just do it, just pick her up. You'll be fine. And I have been. And I was worried about nothing kind of all of this time. And it's an amazing thing for me because I can honestly say, since she's arrived, it's probably this is the most comfortable I've been about my disability.
Is that right?
I don't particularly what's left to worry about now. You know, I've got a daughter. You know, and you know, I've got my job for a little bit longer. I hope.
Disability quotas. You will.
Yeah, disability quotas are amazing. And you know, also they're more resilient than what you think. The kids, I've dropped her like twice. They're fine.
It never affected you. You dropped all childhood. You've been fine, haven't you?
And the big question, and here's the other one, because, you know, I've got a couple of kids and Alex was always asking
me... Can I just make my big announcement as well?
Yeah.
I haven't become a father. So I'm getting absolutely hammered tonight and lying in.
Were you able to change nappies?
What's that?
Are you able to change nappies?
Yeah, I changed the nappies. You've got to do something, because I can't feed her, even though she has gone for my tit a couple of times and I know I need to lose weight, but I don't... I had a good Christmas.
And this was the thing, and this was the one thing that Alex had said to me, like, you know, because we're both missing bits, we do kind of share moments like this, and we used to talk, and Alex would go, what am I going to be able to hold her? Am I going to be able to change a nappy? And what I wanted to say to you was, I've seen you open a can of Coke. If you can do that, you can change a nappy. And then what stopped me was, yeah, but you open cans of Coke with your mouth.
I started doing the nappies with my mouth and it worked great.
I've seen you open a can of Coke and that's why you've got these.
As always, we will do our best to answer your big questions this week. You can tweet them to us at The Last League. Use the hashtag #IsItOK. For example, is it OK that this week alone the government's been forced to issue a description of what their Brexit terms are going to be? Labour MPs have resigned because they're being forced to vote for it. Donald Trump has advocated torture, pledged to build a wall across the Mexican border and ban people from Muslim countries. And it was revealed a Trident nuclear test went wildly off course. No! On the other hand, is it OK to think Rory McGrath picked the right week to plead guilty to harassment? Now, while even more Labour MPs resigned today over the Brexit vote, the Prime Minister flew to Washington to meet the man who dubbed himself Brexit plus plus plus. Adam Wilkinson said, is it OK that Theresa May now seems to be siding with Trump? It's happened. The president with the world's tiniest hands met with his first world leader today.
Don't listen to him.
There's still hope for you. The woman he refers to as his Maggie. Apparently, Trump calls Theresa May his Maggie, which is a reference to the famous Reagan-Thatcher period, which means we are now entering a phase known as May-Trump. which also describes Alex after a fairly hefty curry. Theresa May said on the flight on the way over that she was pretty sure she was going to get along with Trump because opposites attract.
They're not opposites. They're two right-wing political leaders. It's not like he was meeting Ryland Clark. Like... I think it was interesting, because I don't know, I watched the press conference afterwards.
Yep.
And it was kind of weird, because they'd had this interview and then they kind of had to both go out and talk about how it had gone, and it was a bit like the last bit of First Dates. It was just them going, yeah, am I going to see her again? Well, you'll have to ask her first. It was...
I think it's, you know, people are saying that she's siding with Trump now, but, you know, kind of Theresa May's got to kind of get along with him and put up with him for the sake of, you know, doing trade deals. I can imagine she's kind of like, you know what you're like when you get, like, a racist cab driver and you're kind of in the back and you've got to go, yeah, and she's in there just going, she's gone in there going, yeah, bloody Mexicans, yeah, keep going. sign that paper, please, Donald.
I don't know why they bother with these now, because they used to do it, obviously, Reagan and Thatcher, because, like, it was the olden days, but they've met for, what, 45 minutes? Have they not got Skype? Like, he's on Twitter. Just tweet him. He's on all the time.
Yeah.
Like, it's a complete waste of everyone's time. It's Robert. She's just getting her air miles up. That's what she's doing.
I think maybe they're going to be the perfect couple. They're that couple. You know, I mean, we all know someone. We all know a really obnoxious, boorish, loudmouth guy who's got a lovely wife who's a bit calm and kind of placates him. Maybe... Yeah. I can imagine them at a party and him going, torture, torture works! And she's, oh, don't mind him, he doesn't know what he's saying. I mean, and we're all thinking, well, if she had any sense, she'd leave him, but sadly, she needs the money. Here are some of the highlights of today's meeting. Theresa May said that Donald Trump was 100% behind NATO. Although, again, that was like a married couple because he didn't say it. She said it. Well, she went, you're 100% behind NATO, aren't you? And he went, oh, shit, yeah, yeah.
You could do anything after the meeting. She could have come around and gone, great news, he's giving £1 billion a day to the UK, it's going to be brilliant. And he said Vladimir Putin is a tit.
He did say, interestingly enough, that even though he believes in torture, he probably won't because he's going to defer to his general and his general doesn't believe in it. And then afterwards, they walked off holding hands.
Yeah, that's... Do you know what that is? That's her going, keep your hand where I know where it is.
Yeah, well, judging by this photo, that may not have worked.
I don't know, though, moving on from some of the stuff he has said, I think this is a little bit of progress.
I mean, it didn't augur well earlier in the week, because the White House put out press releases saying that she was coming and she was going to have the meeting, but they misspelt her name. They spelled it without the H. They spelt it T-E-R-E-S-A, Theresa May, which, as Alex told us all this week, is a porn star. Pretend you didn't know.
I just read it in the papers.
She does also like leather trousers, though. Well.
Yeah, and is pushing for a hard Brexit. I'm sure, and look, I'm sure Theresa May made a very good case for having close ties with Britain, but Mr. Trump, if you're watching, we've got a couple more reasons for you to get close to us. Alex still runs Little Hand Club. You have an open invitation anytime.
Yeah. Wednesday nights, 9 o'clock, East Finchley.
And if the rumours about Russian prostitutes are true, you're going to love it in Britain because it's always pissing down. Now,
I do have another club for Donald. That's on Thursday nights, just to do with that as well.
So never get the two mixed up. If you don't know, by the way, that was a reference to the fact that there were some highly disputed intelligence reports while we were off air that Donald Trump once paid Russian prostitutes to urinate on a hotel bed because President Obama had previously slept in that bed.
That doesn't make sense. Does he not know how time works? He's doing it in the wrong order. I think he's just gone, I've pissed the bed. I tell you what's less embarrassing, prostitutes pissed on my bed.
I reckon, even though it was, you know, probably rubbish, I bet you Theresa May's not taking any chances staying in the White House tonight. She's like, yeah, I won't have the bed, I'll just have this beanbag and the corner <bonnet on." laughs>
So were you not aware of it? There was a bit of people here... Who was aware of those rumours of the... Wow, OK, because it was kind of a big thing that apparently he paid prostitutes to urinate on the bed. He's completely denied it, but maybe that's why he likes waterboarding. You know, maybe he just doesn't actually know what it means. Maybe he's going to be a prisoner in Guantanamo in 2 years' time going, well, this is much better than I thought it was going to be. I'll tell you everything you need to know, just keep doing this. The thing is, we predicted that story. Because remember last year, we had people urinating on urinals of the Republican nominees to see who we thought was going to win.
I would say...
Yeah.
I mean, that didn't... how I pictured the night with the prostitutes. And I did picture that. No.
Now, look, a lot of people were debating the torture question yesterday. Whilst that was happening, comedian Lee Hurst made the news because he tweeted this, OK? It's word for word. Your baby is tied to a time bomb. You have the terrorist. He tells you you have 1 hour. Do you torture him to find your baby or let it die? Now, to be fair, we're not sure if he was making a pointed comment about the news or pitching a new task for the Crystal Maze.
And I mean, they say the GCSE maths questions are getting easier, aren't they?
But the thing is that what happens at antenatal classes? Week one, breathing. Week two, your baby is tied to a bomb. No one's ever been tied to a bomb except Roadrunner.
I don't know, mate. You turn your back on them for a second, these babies, and before you know it, the terrorists are there, the time bomb's on, yeah. And you've only got an hour, apparently, so...
Wait, what do you think... OK, what
do
did you
think if my baby was tied to a bomb?
I'd show them an episode of this and they'd definitely let them through.
No, what do you think of torture as a method?
I'd like to talk to people first before I do it, but...
But the thing is, I suppose, in that actual instance...
Yeah.
I don't know, it is kind of like...
I know, but you've got to not look at that instance. Like, how often has there been a terrorist attack where a terrorist has gone, right, we've got your baby, it's tied to a tie bomb, you've got an hour? That never happens.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, mate, that's like the stuff with, like, you know, shows like 24, the public never knew about it, and that's why Jack Bauer was such a hero.
He's got a good point, Adam.
He has got a very good point, yeah.
How do you know how many babies have been tied to time bombs? You don't.
Well, do you know what I do?
The thing with torture is...
I really don't know where I was going as soon as I opened my mouth then.
I do feel like this show is now a time bomb.
I think it is worth saying, though, that it has been... a lot of the reason that a lot of our governments don't get involved in torture is not just because of the moral reasons, but because it doesn't work. Because when you torture someone, they're more than likely to just tell you any old shit and then you go off chasing it and it turns out you've just been chasing shit.
Well, what you need to do is test it on a proven liar. Like Donald Trump.
I wonder if he's been really clever, because he's announced a lot of things this week that haven't really amounted to much. Do you know what I mean? He said, yeah, I believe in torture, but then he said, but I probably won't because my general doesn't believe we should. He said the wall's going to go up, but then said, oh, but it's going to take a few months and we'll get Mexico to pay for it eventually. He said he's going to repeal Obamacare, but also said in an interview, yeah, but probably not for a couple of years until it starts failing. He's sent out, all the people that supported him are going to go, yeah, he's doing what we said. But he's really not doing that much. So in a weird way, that's kind of a positive, isn't it? I'm not sure.
I think you are desperately looking for a positive in a world that is going to die.
Well, he also
welcome to Channel 4!
He also ended a thing called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which was a trade agreement that was quite controversial. Even Bernie Sanders applauded him for that one. The Dow Jones hit 20,000 this week for the first time ever. I'm desperately trying to find positives.
I'll be honest with you, I don't know what the Dow Jones is, and I don't know if 20,000 is good or bad.
20,000 what?
Dows. I've never had so many Dows.
So there's 20,000 Dows. How many Joneses to the Dow?
15 Joneses to the Dow.
So that's a lot of Joneses.
Knee deep in Joneses.
No, I'm not going to go there.
Let's look at the negatives.
That was one of the porn films Theresa May was in.
Let's look at the negatives of the week. Trump signed orders to stop funding to overseas clinics that provide or even talk about abortion. He suspended visas for immigrants from several countries, including Iran, Iraq, Syria and Afghanistan.
The immigrants bit's not funny.
He's proposed the publication of a weekly list of crimes committed by immigrants in the United States.
Yeah, but we've got that here. It's called the Daily Mail. We can't complain.
Ashley Leanne said, is it OK that Trump's White House is already resembling a North Korean dictatorship? Now, and again, look, I don't know how scared to be about what's going on with Donald Trump. Do you know what I mean? But there's people that are saying this is the beginning of an authoritarian leader. Mm. There are other people going, just back off, let's not get carried away. So, let's check a few things off on the North Korean dictator's playbook. Appoints close relative to a government post? Tick. Arrests journalists for covering unfavourable protests? Tick. Declares the day he came to power a national day of patriotic devotion. Tick. Lies about his own golf prowess. Tick. Has crazy hair. Oh, my sweet God! I mean, the only thing missing is making outrageous demands when he visits foreign countries. Donald Trump has said when he visits the UK, he would like to play golf on the Queen's private golf course while she watches on.
From anyone else, that sentence would sound right, but Donald Trump said he wants to play golf on the Queen's private course is while she watches on. It's
this is not,
it would have been worse
up.
If he said while she caddies. I hope that they kind of have to meet him halfway and he's like, right, you can have Laser Quest with Princess Eugenie. That's what you get.
I'm not making that up. This is what he wants when he comes to the UK.
Air hockey with Prince Harry. Done. Go ape, Prince Andrew. Let's do this.
I could go on.
Theresa
May did extend the invitation today. Tracy said, is it OK for Trump to be guest of the royal family when he tweets stuff like this? In 2012, you remember when Kate Middleton was photographed sunbaking? He's tweeted, who wouldn't take Kate's picture and make lots of money if she does the nude sunbathing thing? Come on, Kate. Ooh, that's going to be awkward, isn't it? Especially when Theresa May did extend that invitation. And according to an article in The Telegraph, Trump wants all the pomp and ceremony when he gets here, more so than any other American leader has ever had. His people have asked for a full Monty visit. I do not think that phrase means what you think it means. A full Monty visit. But look, you know, we want to get this trade deal across the line, so President Donald Trump, if you're watching, this is your full Monty welcome.
Me and him would do it. You said no.
No, did you hear the screams from the audience? Yeah, that's what I wanted. I wanted women going, oh my God, yeah! Not, oh, put that away! All right, let's bring out our first guest. He's one of the most loved actors in Britain. He starred in Broadchurch, Doctor Who, and Fireman Sam. Would you please welcome David Tennant? David, firstly, thank you so much for coming on, because you're not well, are you?
I'm not. This is my honey and lemon. I know, I'm on my last leg.
Lovely work.
Now, there is a lovely connection to you and Donald Trump, weirdly, because when he said Scotland voted out of the EU after the Brexit referendum, you went on American television to read some of the tweets that came from Scotland, including my personal favourite, they voted Remain and they hate your guts, you ludicrous tangerine ball bag. Now, I know some celebrities don't want to express an allegiance either way when it comes to American politics because of the American fan base. Did you have any worries about that? Or were you OK with it?
I think it was hard. Well, it didn't... I mean, back then, it felt like a fantasy. It felt ludicrous that, you know, I was just joining in the jeepery.
Yeah.
I mean, he was never going to win, was he?
No. So... I've noticed Adam's changed his tune a lot in the last few weeks as well. Shitting yourself.
Well, I mean, the two people I've taken the piss out of most on this show are Putin and Trump.
Yeah.
I'm fucked.
That's why I pick on Alex.
But you told me you were in Portland recently filming.
I was.
What was the vibe like there after the election?
Portland, Oregon was is a lovely city, very compassionate city, as it turns out, quite sort of hipstery and cool. And
yeah.
They were devastated by the result of the election. And what I found quite moving is that all the shops there have put up this poster saying, we welcome all races, all genders, all religions.
Wow.
You know, please come in, you're welcome, you're safe here.
Yeah.
And, you know, in the sort of wake of this apocalypse, that felt like that's what we all need to do. There needs to be a sort of, some kind of reaching out, some kind of...
Oh, I think that is exactly the way to go. I don't know if you saw the inauguration last week. There were some lighter moments, including this ranger who was interviewed just before the event. Listen out for his hilarious name.
Mike Litteris from the National Park Service. Mike, how are things going this morning so far?
What? Mike Litteris. No. Mike Litteris. If your last name's Litteris, don't call your child Mike. That's never good. Mike Litteris.
Litteris isn't even a surname.
To be fair, we tried to get Mike Litteris on the show. He is very hard to find. I'll be honest, I'm not even sure he exists.
Welcome to the 1970s.
While many people that were there to support Donald Trump, some people were angrier than others.
To be able to introduce for the first time ever anywhere the 45th President of the United States of America, Donald J. Trump.
They cut it off there just before she went, party for home!
That's a word like when you say you're going to sing it at the end of a show.
Either she was upset by the inauguration or she couldn't find Mike Litteris. And look, UK-US relations could have soured earlier on this week when it was announced that a Trident nuclear missile test failed last June when the missile took a wrong turn and actually headed towards Florida.
It sounds like they've got Uber to start running it. Mate, you're going the wrong way. This is meant for not... use your Google Maps or something.
You don't want an Uber nuclear missile.
No,
mainly because when the war starts, you have to pay surge prices. You know what? For me, I reckon having a missile that you don't know where it's going to go is actually a bigger nuclear deterrent, isn't it?
Particularly if you tie a baby to it.
If you can say to other countries around the world, look, we've only got one, but we have no idea where it's going to go, they are probably going to leave you alone. And the Americans couldn't get upset about it because the system that failed was made by an American company, Alex's favourite company, Lockheed Martin.
They're not my favourite because of the stuff they make.
Yeah.
They're my favourite because I think that Lockheed Martin sounds like a Scottish bloke, you know, down the pub who can't twist his neck.
Oh, Martin.
I've been sat on that joke for a year.
It was cut out of about four separate episodes previously. We've got to talk about Lockheed Martin one day, and boy, did it pay out.
You know, right now, there's someone in a Scottish pub going, if I could see that television, I'd be ugly. you used to live in Glasgow, where Trident was based. Were you aware? Did it bother you?
To be honest, I mean, this may be to do with my own ignorance at the time, but it didn't feel like something that was hotly debated particularly. It was just there.
Right.
Like just in the middle of the street. Just in Smith's.
It's like Thunderbird, it opens up. And out it comes. But I think Scotland's become a very different country, and I think part of the genius of Nicola Sturgeon and Alex Salmond before is that they've made these very hot issues, about the national divide.
Yeah.
Which is fair enough.
So we now know that there are missiles in Scotland that may go the wrong direction when they're fired.
Well, quite.
Hooray!
Yeah, brilliant.
Moving on, Joanne Byrne said, is it OK that lies are now being called alternative facts? Newspeak, doublespeak, Orwell's angry ghost will haunt us all. Now, this is a massive thing that came out this week.
Yeah.
And if you don't know about it, I'm going to start by introducing you to a man called Sean Spicer. Sean Spicer is the new press secretary for the administration, for Donald Trump.
So everyone's got a name that could be in a porn film tonight. Sean Spicer, Mike Litteris and Theresa May.
This is some of... Now, Sean Spicer gave a press conference last week after the inauguration. Donald Trump was very upset that people showed photos that seemed to suggest there weren't as many people there as President Obama. Spicer got up and made this claim.
This was the largest audience to ever witness an inauguration, period, both in person and around the globe.
So he said that. He said Trump had the largest audience ever for an inauguration. He blamed the floor coverings for making the audience look smaller than it actually was. He also said Trump got a 5-minute... I'm not kidding.
Smaller because they were so high, they just looked short. Yes.
Well, they were big white floor coverings.
Oh, okay.
And so from a distance, he says, well, the white floor coverings stood out. I mean, we don't know from a distance.
I imagine with Donald Trump's crowd, that's a pretty white crowd, as it is.
And maybe they just left their sheets at the back.
Also, all those burning crosses as well. There we go.
He also said Trump got a 5-minute standing ovation at the CIA. Now, all of this turned out to be absolute bullshit. And when challenged on the truth of those claims, senior advisor Kellyanne Conway called them the now famous term alternative facts. And that's... they're lies. they're lies. No, that's not an alternative fact. Is when you go to the doctor and she says you've only got a month left to live, so you go, well, I'd like an alternative fact, and she goes, well, you're now financially set for life. That's an alternative fact. Carl Deaker said, is it okay for the media to use your bullshit button during a Sean Spicer press conference or a Trump speech? I don't think the bullshit button is made for this level of bullshittery. I don't think it's going to last the season. All right, let's go through a list of statements made recently by both Trump and Spicer. Let's see how they fare. You say them, I'll judge them. Okay. Josh first.
Donald Trump said he lost the popular vote because millions of illegal votes were cast for Hillary Clinton.
Bullshit.
Trump later claimed that he didn't actually say there were millions of illegal votes cast.
Bullshit.
Trump said there were a couple of drops of rain before he gave his inauguration speech, but it stopped immediately and became sunny.
Bullshit.
Sean Spicer eats 35 pieces of gum a day, and he doesn't spit them out, he swallows.
That's true, actually.
Donald Trump says he holds a record for the amount of appearances on the cover of Time magazine.
Bullshit.
Trump said he has received many, many environmental awards.
I'll be honest, I'm not sure how many more this button can take. Yeah, keep going.
Trump tweeted the Fox News coverage of the inauguration was way higher than the CNN coverage.
Bullshit.
Trump claimed two people were shot in Chicago this year while President Obama made a speech.
Bullshit.
Trump continually claims he won the election in a landslide.
Bullshit.
We have officially broken the bullshit button, ladies and gentlemen. Week one of the year, we are going to need a bigger button. We'll have more Last Leak for you after the break as we ask, is it OK to punch a Nazi? That's right. Welcome to 2017. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to Last Leg, where we're still joined by David Tennant, and we now have a bigger button. It has two keys, it's nuclear and...
Bullshit.
Good, it's going to see us through the rest of the year. Peter Kilbane said, is it OK to punch a Nazi? Now...
I like the idea that he was like that when he was texting.
That refers to this startling moment during the inauguration of Donald Trump, in which alt-right figurehead Richard Spencer was being interviewed about the fact that someone had just punched him, and someone punched him.
Are you like the hipster version of the neo-Nazi movement?
It's Pepe's become kind of a symbol.
Applause in the audience. To make things clear, we have to point out Richard Spencer doesn't see himself as a Nazi, but everyone else does, basically. He's written articles musing on what he calls the peaceful ethnic cleansing of black people from America. So you can understand why people cheered on. Now, here's the thing. Is it OK to do that?
I think, for me, with all of these things, it's not a case of, would I punch a Nazi? It's physically, can I?
There is that. Yeah, there is that.
And that's what I'd ask myself
first. Your reach isn't what you used to think it was,
no,
is it?
No, I'd have had to get in a lot closer. But you don't know that bloke punched him because he was a Nazi. Maybe he's just like, sorry, you were the bloke who just blocked me in the car. No. Oh, shit.
It's weird because, OK, I'm going to take an audience. How many people here think it's OK for him to have done that? By round of applause. It's interesting. It's really interesting. David, what do you think?
Well, as Donald J. Trump, who's the new leader of the free world, I don't know if you've heard of him, as he said last week, fight fire with fire, which is not a tactic ascribed to by most of the fire departments in the country. I think you have to take the moral high ground, don't you? I mean, it's hard. Takes a, you know, chewing of the side of the mouth to keep it down, but...
It's the thing with Nazis, they're real wankers. It's difficult. I think the thing about that is the footage is so brutal.
Seeing it.
Like, I think maybe you should judge... You could hurt a Nazi, but as long as you do it in a funny way. Okay. You have to do it like one of the ways that he hurt the burglars in Home Alone.
Okay.
You can do whatever you want to a Nazi as long as it was done to Joe Pesci in Home Alone. Click on a string, bang, good fight.
We criticised Donald Trump for saying his supporters should punch protesters in the face. Can we justify anyone punching a supposed Nazi in the face? We are interested in your opinion. That is tonight's poll. Is it OK to punch a Nazi? Tweet us at the Last Leg, use the hashtag punch yes or punch no.
We've got a Nazi here and at the end we will be doing one or the other.
We know, I think the best way to respond is something that we already know, something we saw in a clip, it's now a famous clip, a man who followed KKK members on their way to a march, he followed them with a sousaphone and did this. Now, I mean, do you know what I mean? I know what you mean. I think that what that guy has said is abhorrent, and what Nazis stand for is absolutely appalling, clearly. But if he's being interviewed on the street and he doesn't know you're there, if you could just stand next to him with a sousaphone.
Yeah.
Do you know, and clearly, it's very difficult to carry a sousaphone at all times, so here's what we're going to do for you tonight. To arm you for the times ahead, we are going to bring out our sousaphone player, John. John, come on out, OK?
If you're at home, get your phones ready to record. Okay, get your phone out now. Hold it up to TV. Get ready to record because John is going to play the tune on his sousaphone. It is your job to record it onto your phone. And if you ever come face to face with a Nazi talking shit, play the tune. This is our gift to you. And in fact, audience as well. Audience here, get your phones out. I've got mine ready as well. Okay, we're going to put it onto. I guess it's we're going to do voice memo.
Well. The worry would be that then I'd come face to face with a Nazi, not be able to find the right one. Go up to him, press play, and he'd hear me going, idea for a TV show. Just joshing, a prank show before the water show.
All right, everyone, phones ready. Ready to start recording.
Some Nazis out this weekend, and they're going to be like, they're out there Nazi-ing, and they're going to be like, can you hear the muffled sound of a sousaphone that sounds like it's been recorded off TV? And they go, yeah, I can. Should we stop Nazi-ing?
I'll be honest, for a moment there, I couldn't work out why the audience weren't applauding. Then I went, oh, they're putting their phones away. let's move on from Nazis to something cheerier now, like cancer. Government scientists. Let's be honest, on the scale, government scientists announced this week you can apparently get cancer from French fries, brown toast, and crispy roast potatoes.
And that's why Mr. Potato Head's bald.
Crispy roast potatoes may give you cancer. Here's how one person reacted to that news.
President of the United States of America, Donald J. Trump.
Apparently, slightly burning starchy foods create something called acrylamide, which may, and look, I have to repeat this, it may cause cancer. But when this was released, a lot of cancer research experts said, well, it's a pretty vague link. We haven't even proved it. Maybe just cut down on the cigarettes and the alcohol first.
It's kind of... They tested it on mice.
Yeah.
And they go, oh, we fed these mice these roast potatoes and they died. And you go, yeah, that's because it's not as big... The mouse isn't as big as a potato. A mattress, I'd die.
I think we all do that thing when you hear something like this. Of you weigh it up and you go, okay, how much do I like roast potatoes? How much is this really going to take off the end of my life? Am I willing to take this? And I've kind of got to this point where, do you know what? I mean, I look after myself pretty well, but I don't think I could give up toast or roast potatoes. No. And in fact, I'd like to eat them both together. I've invented this week a thing called the roasty toasty.
There's about 6 pop-up shops in Shoreditch that do that.
I think that roasty toasty sounds like something you'd read on, like, the Urban Dictionary. It's like something sexual involving a potato.
Something involving Mike Litteris and...
steamer.
Well, I've decided the gain is worth the risk. And, in fact, can you bring out... This is the most dangerous thing you can eat, apparently. This is a roasty toasty. All right.
David is already ill.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's hand these out. We're each going to try a roasty toasty. Do you know what? I'm sick of being told what I can and can't eat, what's good for you and what's not good for you. In your face, cancer. Are you watching this?
So this could be the last thing I ever eat?
Oh.
By the way, that stuff on the laptop, it ain't mine.
Oh, this is great. This is great. Screw you, cancer. I don't care. I don't smoke. I hardly
You've
drink.
You got any brown sauce?
Do you know what? It probably needs sauce. It's a little dry. This dish may be only 3 minutes.
Oh, my God, that is so dry! I think I'm going to dehydrate to death!
How do I even put this on my fitness pal?
We'll be back with more of The Last Leg in a bit. Do that. Where we're still joined by David Tennant, and I've got to say, a lot of excitement went around the office this week.
Oh, yes.
Because we've looked at all the projects that you've got coming up. You've got another series of Broadchurch coming up. You're appearing as Don One in London in March.
Yeah.
You are the voice of Scrooge McDuck in the new series of DuckTales.
Yeah!
She And this is it. I mean, people say that the world's going to shit. If somebody had said to me, Donald Trump in exchange for DuckTales coming back, yes, please.
have you recorded it?
We've done most of the series, I think, yeah.
Shall we ask the question?
Yeah.
Does he dive into the money?
Of course he dives.
Yes!
God,
I love it.
And now, listen, Rolling Stone magazine named your character in the Netflix series Jessica Jones as one of the top 40 TV villains of all time.
Right.
Which accent did you go with for that?
Oh, you know, snarly English.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, because apparently that is the perfect accent for a film villain.
It just fits. You try. Yeah. You can try other things, but you end up coming back to that.
Can you do it for us?
What do you want me to say?
Say, Adam, Trump's coming to get you.
Adam, Trump's coming to get you.
Oh, I mean, listen, I have seen Jessica Jones and that freaks me out a lot now. but apparently it's the posh English accent in particular because it's more educated but considered less trustworthy.
Mm.
And the only other time you see...
I thought it was all British accents, so I've been worried this week, like, people are going to think I'm untrustworthy. So I went in the shops the other day doing a Chinese accent. People do not like it.
No, I think your accent's the lovable rogue. Do you know what I mean? In Hollywood, if it's posh, yeah, then it's the villain. If it's the lovable rogue, a cheeky chappy...
What about...
What's yours? comedy sidekick?
The role I have made my own.
Do you know what I mean? I'm pretty sure you're never going to be a villain. That's right. I've taken you hostage. I'm not... Just...
Do you know what?
Yeah.
I'm counting that round of applause as for me.
I mean, so other accents don't work. Geordie's never going to work. Why, hey, Mr. Bond, you found me little underground booker. Aussie accent definitely wouldn't suit a Bond villain, but it does suit whiny. We have the best accent for being whiny. Watch this clip. Even as I said whiny, it sounds right. Watch this clip. Now, this was leaked, this clip. Watch the way the hosts on the left have an argument during an ad break. The guest on the right looks awkward, but then once the cameras roll, they are absolutely best friends.
I need Julie to put a jacket on because we're all in white. I asked her before we came on. Julie, you need to put a jacket on.
Blood out, I haven't had time. Does someone...
I told you 2 hours ago. We know
Amber,
in chat room.
This is not... So I'm sorry, I've been flat out.
Well,
honestly.
I'll call wardrobe and we'll get something.
No, if you give me a second, if we can ask... I'm not sure who your lineup is today. If there's just a jacket floating around out there, ask Danica.
Unless you want to run down and see if there's a jacket.
No, you're right. No, you're right, because you told me it's fine, Sandy, but there can't be three of us.
No.
And I've made this clear 2.5 hours ago.
Amber, if it's an issue, I can get on out of here.
It is an issue. Go and grab a jacket. Time now to head into the chat room, and joining me today is psychologist Sandy Ray in Melbourne and Nine's Julie Snook in Sydney. A big welcome to both of you. Thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon.
we'll be back with more of The Last Leg in a bit as Josh wraps up the last 7 days. See you soon.
Love that track.
That's me. I'm the sausage.
I mean, Alex, I told you 2.5 hours ago we can't wear the same prosthetic on the show tonight.
Adam, I've been flat out. I've been doing those roasty toasties. Just out of time.
2.5 hours I gave you, Alex. 2.5 hours.
Look, but if there's somebody...
Do you want me to go and get a wheelchair? I could go and put myself in a wheelchair.
No, you're good, Josh. I know you've got two legs.
Thank
Alex,
you.
I'm just going to call wardrobe and get another one.
Well, yeah, somebody's got one from wardrobe. I think we had a couple left over from the Paralympics, but, you know, I've been flat
out. I'm so sick of this shit. It happens every week. We're on air any second. Josh and Alex, my best buddies in the world. My best friends in the world. David Tennant is here as well. Sam Daly said it isn't okay to praise Ewan McGregor for refusing to be interviewed by Trump puppet Piers Morgan after his Women's March comments this week. Piers Morgan said some stuff about the Women's March. Ewan McGregor said he wasn't going on this show. What do you think? Should he have done it, or did he make the right call making a stand?
The thing about this is it's all about Piers Morgan, isn't it? It's all about him. It just feels like he's sitting at home thinking, how can I make more people talk about me?
Yeah, yeah.
And here we are. You know. I mean, he's an intelligent man. He can't really believe that ignorant nonsense he tweeted, can he?
So I think when it comes to Piers Morgan, what you have to do is you have to debate him calmly, you have to not argue, you have to get your point across and make sure it's clear. And I think the best way to do that is to hack into his phone and leave it as an outgoing voicemail message.
Josh has been scraping the barrel of the last 7 days. What have you found?
Would you like to see why they rarely shoot adverts on ice?
Yes, please.
I wore the wrong socks. I wore the wrong socks. Have you tried the hot dogs here? Needless to say, I didn't get my deposit. Needless to say, I didn't get my deposit back. And Viper Mitsubishi is a proud sponsor of Golden Gopher Hockey.
Very quickly, we wanted to know, is it okay to punch a Nazi? 74% of you said yes. Oh. 74% said yes, 26% said no. We have totally misread the room. Very briefly, some is it okays came in. Are you feeling better, by the way?
I'm getting there.
Yeah, well done to the person who said, is it okay to say Dr. Flu?
No. Yes, please.
Amy Dwyer said, is it okay that I can't stop giggling because I thought your baby Alex on the desk was a golem? Yeah, except the ring's wasted.
What the? Oh, but is the show nearly done yet?
That's all we've got time for tonight. Would you please thank our guests? David Tennant! And my co-host, Josh Widdicombe! Alex Brooker! Next week, we'll be joined by comedian Russell Brand, but after a week of nuclear mishaps, presidential orders and cancer scares, Nikki tweeted to say, please tell us it'll be OK. Can David Tennant act in a reassuring voice and tell us it'll be OK? Do you know what? I think that is the perfect way to end the show. David, okay, would you like to take centre stage, please, and tell us it'll all be OK?
It's all going to be OK. Trust me. I'm a doctor. But it's up to us to make it OK. It's time to be positively rebellious and rebelliously positive. As long as we stand up for what we believe in, don't give in to anger or violence. Look out for the little guy. Keep an eye on the big guys. Refuse to keep our mouths shut. And just generally try not to be dicks. Every little thing is going to be all right.
He's right. He's right. Every little thing is going to be all right. And in fact, I think I feel a song coming on.